show us about.
Thank you. You were born up north near Adwa.
Yes.
63 years ago.
Yes.
Have you grown old?
Physically. Inside, you don't grow old. Neither your mind nor your stomach grows old. The stomach also will eat always, and the mind will work. It's the skin and the things that make us look old.
Not even the skin. Do you frequently see yourself in the mirror? You've got a gray hair, but you have a baby's face. How do you explain that?
Magic from the genes. I don't know.
Whose genes? From your father's line or from your mother's line?
Certainly my mother's. And, but as Shakespeare's comedian said, that you are my son, I have partly your mother's word and partly my own suspicions.
And
I don't know who my father is. How can I? But I am sure, without knowing.
The father that you knew was indeed your father.
Indeed, because there was no possibility in a small village for my mother to have a child from anybody else.
Did he want you to be a peasant?
My father had no idea we would be anything else than farmers like himself. Neither did we.
You came here and you went to a boarding school, am I right?
I came right to a boarding school, Tafari Mokonnen School.
Did you?
Throughout high school, boarding school.
Was it, in a way, a culture shock for you, waiting for you out there when you came
no,
to Addis Ababa?
It was beautiful. When you are that young, there is no culture shock.
But
if you go into a new culture after you've grown up, then there is culture shock. But then there was no culture shock. I just dived in like a fish into water or something.
So you were very well in place when you came here to Addis at age 10?
Except I missed my parents.
That is, in a way, a shock, isn't it?
My goodness.
How do you compensate that loss?
But not me, God compensates.
In what way?
I went to school. I learned the English language. And I read such beautiful books from the English themselves, from translations, especially from the Russians, from the Arabian Nights. I was more than compensated. Tafari Mokonnen School.
And
his Imperial Majesty's own school. If you
why? Because
mind.
This was the only, for the privileged ones, the only school that we had.
For the privileged ones, the privileged few, and for the lucky many.
It was pure luck that got you there.
On my part, yes.
But you weren't happy about the people who ran this school. There were the Jesuits.
Of course. When you're a student, you're never happy with the director and the teachers and so on.
But not always.
Just as when you're a citizen, you're not happy with the government and the police and so on. But they are necessary. There was too much discipline because they were monks, Jesuit monks. But I'm glad they gave us the discipline. For example, if I had a son, and if I could send him to a Jesuit school, I would.
You'll be glad to.
Without hesitation. Even though they teach him some nonsense, they teach him more education.
Were you a rebel?
I beg pardon?
Were you a rebel as a young boy in
Tafari? Any young boy is a rebel. Some it shows, on some it doesn't show, but we don't like the world of the grown-ups, with all its orders and so on and so forth.
Do you remember the first book that you ever read?
No. No. I remember the first girl I ever had, but not the first book.
Who is that first girl?
the first girl you get interested in lives in the desert. Ube Beraha.
The typical setting for your stories.
Yes. How for us, they were girls, really.
You were deeply in love.
Well, deeply, to be deeply in love, you have to be the only man and she has to be the only woman. Minus that.
In a world where there are too many men, there could be an absolute love. Is that what you're saying?
Where we have to share. It's a marketplace. It happens exceptionally.
You were a group of young boys who went out to have fun.
Right. Life sometimes is like a poem. I told you about going to the desert. For about 2 years we went there as often as we could. And I took notes, meaning to write about that place. Because that was the only place in Ethiopian history that was unique. Because it was at the same time a whoring prostitution place. At the same time, the women were not prostitutes. We treated each other like human beings.
Like equals.
Except money had to... It was a very strange... I thought this was, for our time, the place to write about. At that time, Emile Zola was my guide, a French writer and a fighter. I only write, he also fights. He took notes and notes and he wrote about life. He only added a little art. So I wanted to do like him.
Same thing.
Yes. So I went to Aix-en-Provence and when I dropped classes, I wrote about Weber.
And you called it Leto Mainegalin,
right.
Which translates like...
Endless night.
Endless night.
Youth passing away like the night.
That's what it is.
Approximately.
And it never was published?
No, not yet. Not yet.
Not yet. Why? So much obscenity in there?
So much obscenity.
Why are you interested in obscenity? You want to offend the societies that you live in?
Sir, I'm not interested in obscenity. I'm interested in writing life as it is.
But
and in the desert, it's prostitution, and the conversation is about those things, right? As the farmer talks about his tools. That's the talk.
But when you turn it into some form of art, in your case, writing, why didn't you give it a little touch and make it a little bit presentable,
because,
so to say, quote unquote?
Because at the time, and still, I believe, quoting Zola, we will give the picture of life with its words. We will not paint it to beautify it as it is. If God made it, we are only mirrors of God, if that. So who are we to change it? Because we respect our reader. What we saw, the reader can see. What was painful to us, he will feel pain. What was beautiful in the most unexpected places, like beautiful love between two people that we saw, the reader can understand. If I understood, my reader can understand.
Do you write what you live? Because apparently you told me earlier on that Weber Berha was the places that you were hanging out, was one of the places that you were hanging out in those days.
Mm.
And you loved life of that sort those days as a young Sibhat.
Right.
Do you write what you live, or you live what you write?
That's like the egg and the hen.
You can take it if you like. Writer today that you were 30 years ago when you were writing about this endless night?
The same man?
The same writer.
The same person, but a different writer. Because writing is like, it's like a craft. when I was a young man, the truth seemed to me to talk about, other than eating and drinking water, not alcohol, other than eating and drinking, the most important about life is making love and reproducing. So it was a most interesting life.
That you had then.
And I wrote it in its own language, in its own situation and so on. But when I'm...
Regardless of what will happen next.
I beg your pardon?
Regardless of what is going to happen next, whether it's going to be published or not. That was not your business anyway.
No, that is the next stage. That's up.
And you're not worried about
there
that?
There is division of labor.
The writer your job writes. Your right?
The writer writes. The society, if it deserves to read, will have a publishing house, will have the other things. If not,
it will
the
stay
written
there.
Thing will wait.
Wouldn't that offend you? Not to see your own works published in your own lifetime?
Not at all. Because I wrote them, really. I enjoyed writing. And
for yourself?
For myself. And afterwards, for friends and so on.
Do I see some egoism there?
Of course.
Are you an egoist person?
Of course. If somebody says he's no egoist, he's saying, I'm Jesus Christ.
Why can't you be one?
One what?
Like Jesus Christ, follow
because
his
footsteps. Because I don't want to be crucified. I don't want to be crucified. I don't want to die for the truth. I want to live in this life with all its lies and so on.
Do you mean that you are one? You're a liar?
When necessary.
Like when?
Like now, if you like, I could lie to you.
Are you lying to me right now? When I ask you those questions that I've been asking over the last 15 minutes?
Obviously, I'm not, but you are trying to lead somewhere.
How naturally does writing come to you?
I should say very naturally.
On command?
Not on command, on inspiration more.
When are you inspired?
Why it comes naturally to me is I write the way I speak, so I don't have to make plans, to do any...
You just...
No technical perfection, no nothing. Just talk, because your reader knows the language you're talking when you're writing to a reader.
Speaking about Tukusat, fever for our Ferengi audience.
Mm-hmm.
You were mocking the old ladies in Aix-en Provence in the garden, sitting there yawning and so on. Now that you're old, what do you feel about those lines?
Yes. It's funny. When I was young, I used to be so disgusted with old age. The way it looks, especially on white people, because we age very differently. Just as when they're young, especially the girls, when they blush, we cannot reproduce it here. It is fantastic, different beauty. And when they grow old, it is equally, it's like wax, people dried and cracked. Frightening. Really, when you are young. But when you arrive at old age, it's just like the mountain looks blue from a distance. When you get there, it's earth. It's like that. Old age is like youth. It has its own excitement, its own beauties, its own grace.
So you love it?
Of course I love it. I would prefer youth.
Are you afraid of death?
Of course. Not as afraid as I used to be. And that is where whoever they are, they know what to do with you. When you're young, by you I mean as I saw it, they make you so afraid of death that you have to live and mate and reproduce and so on. And then you find out when that is over, was a false scare. It's not even scary at all. Except if you are sick or if you're hungry, that always is different. Otherwise, old age has its own charm, its own beauty.
But when you think of death, which might be next door, it is scary.
Mm.
Are you like one of your characters?
By the way, it is not that scary.
Meaning?
Death.
For a man who loves life.
Exactly.
It is scary, isn't it?
When you love life, what they do, whoever they are, is they put the right love in the right place so that the race continues, so that we continue and our children, like we are a continuation. We don't know what this continuation is about. But when you have done your share, you are relieved, you have done your duty. You're no more scared.
You think you've done your share?
I'm no more afraid to die, except I would like it a little later because I want my children not to miss me that much.
You think you've done your share?
No share of what? I had no share. I did what I wanted because I could just as well not have been born and the society would not have missed anything.
How about this Sebatu is alive today?
The Sebatu is alive today. He lives for himself because he's part of society. He will certainly contribute a bit. But as I say, even Shakespeare could have not existed and the English race would have continued.
And that's what you feel about yourself?
Yes. But I'm glad I lived.
Because you were able to...
Because I'm the only one who can live in this skin.
How were you inspired, shall we say, to write in Amharic and not, for example, in English?
Yes, that's a very interesting question. Like in any part of Africa, we are, even if Ethiopia was politically independent, culturally, we were on the periphery of the British Empire. We read most of the books in English. You see? And like the other tribes in Africa, which if he wrote in his own language, he would be read by 10,000 at the most. So he has to write in French or in English.
To be able to be read by...
Yes. Here, we thought, we live in an urban society. Amharic is a language of the countryside. It can't express the life of the city.
That's what you decided?
That's, yes. So I started to write in English, but about Ethiopia. I used to type. I remember it was 65 pages typed. I think 65. Then I came here and I read a book, Adephrus by Danya Choworko. I didn't know who the man was.
You never met him?
No. I read it and then I read it. My goodness. We can write in Amharic about life in this town. In this time. So I dropped writing in English and I started to write in Amharic, and that's how come Fever to Kusat and so on came to you. Thanks to Danyacho for me. This is rare. It's my luck, my star. Because that's a rare man. Man so angry with the whole world. And then he made an exception for me and he protected me.
Okay.
That's how lucky I am.
You were portrayed by Baalu Girma in the late 70s, in his The Author. You gladly accepted to be the main character in his novel. How gladly did you accept that? The book was about Sibhat.
Yes. It's like this. Balu is a very interesting person. He can be with yourself. He can be himself when he's with you. That was how it was with me. And he said, I want to write about a writer. But to write about myself is really, it's not, it doesn't work. So how about I take you as a model? I said, fine, because you are the best-selling author now. If you write about me, when my books come out, I will have been advertised. So it's perfect. So we agreed. So he asked me any number of questions. I answered as truthfully as I could, and he wrote his novel.
And were you happy about the character that was portrayed there in the book?
I accepted it.
Meaning?
About 50-50, which was as it should be.